and it reads like this. It says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust." Verse 1 says, in the secret place of the Most High. I want to talk about God's witness protection. God's witness protection. Our criminal justice system employs a program called witness protection to solve some of its most profound and most difficult and prolific of cases. Witness protection is protection for or of a threatened witness involved in the justice system, involved in the justice process. It includes defendants and other clients before, during, and after even a trial. Individuals enrolled in the witness protection program are usually key witnesses and key ingredients to a case. In some sort of crime, and as a result, they are in danger due to the threat from the criminal on their life. They are valuable to the case because of what they know and who they know. And the criminal has threatened their life simply because of the information they have. When you are a witness to something, you can validate what happened. And while in protection, the witness has around-the-clock officers assigned to their every location. It is in the witness protection program this witness can find safety and security. They can find protection, but that protection comes at a price because they have, although in exchange for their protection, they must give up their privacy. Because of what they know and who they know and what they have, they are enrolled in this witness protection program so that they can, their lives can be saved, their lives can be secure, and the justice system deploys this program so that it can do two things: protect the witness and give justice in the case. The protection comes at the price, and they must choose. The witness must choose, can oftentimes choose to accept or reject the opportunity to be a part of the witness protection program. They do not have to submit to it. They can just take the risk and see what happens. And while a witness may only require protection until the conclusion of a trial, some witnesses are even provided after the trial what's called a new identity because they have gotten so much involved in the case that they are now decided that it has now come critical they can no longer operate under their old identity. Their new identity has to change. Their social number has to change. Their name has to change. Their residence, their address, everything they've ever known, they must forget and have to move forward with a new identity in a new place simply because of what they know. They often live their lives under government protection. It is oftentimes the witness's choice to choose the program. And I want you to understand that all of us as believers have been witness to something that is detrimental to Hell's kingdom. I want you to understand very clearly that when God calls you to be a Christian, when He calls you to be a believer, you are automatically considered a witness. Because when you testify, you are simply taking the witness stand. You say stuff like, "God keep making ways out of nowhere." You say stuff like, "He picked me up, turned me around, placed my feet on solid ground." When you keep on testifying, you are doing nothing but showing the enemy that you are a surprise. But let me be clear. Being a witness is dangerous. Because if Peter were here, he would tell you that he's a witness, but the reason they were in the upper room is because being a witness can be dangerous. Because when a criminal wants to get off on murder, they can, what they do is kill all the witnesses. And I want you to understand that just because you got a testimony, I need you to understand that that automatically qualifies you as hell's most wanted. And let me be clear with you what I tell you. You better enroll in God's witness protection program. There's ain't nothing more dangerous to a court case when there are no witnesses to hang the criminal. There's nothing more frustrating to the prosecution when there are no witnesses to testify against the enemy. And I want you to understand that I know you have a testimony, but if you don't make it to the witness stand, justice cannot be served to the enemy. In our text today, it seems as though this psalmist gives us as believers our very own 911 reference found in Psalms 91, verse 1. The text is tailored to teach us that there is such a place we can find safety and security from danger. It does not suggest that we won't be exposed to danger, but it does not suggest that we are exempt from danger. However, it does ensure us that we are excluded from the effects of danger. Simply put, the weapons will be formed, they just won't prosper. The psalmist invites our thinking to a place that we can call our home court advantage. And all throughout Scripture, God has shown his way to protect those who serve him. Come here, Noah. You remember Noah? Noah in the ark, God has decided he was going to use the earth as a washing machine, and he flooded the entire planet. And he said, Noah, build an ark because I'm going to protect you from my anger. You remember Daniel. Daniel was cast in the lion's den simply because he didn't want to worship the God they told him to worship. And so he got into the lion's den, and suddenly the lions became vegetarian. Because God will protect you. You remember the three Hebrew boys, they were thrown in the fiery furnace, and somehow the fire was present, but it didn't burn them. And I want you to understand that's because God protects us. And all But all I have some characters who read the Bible that can stand up and testify when God protects you. So my question is, what did Daniel and Noah and Abraham and all these that were protected by God have? What did they have that qualifies them for this protection? This protection I see in Psalms 91 verse 1, it's a sacred protection. Let your say sacred. Sacred means that there's something set aside and sanctified. It means it is special and unique for a specific reason. He says, he that dwelleth in the secret place. Now, I like the fact that he says, he that dwelleth. He did not say Christian. He did not say church folk. He did not say black folk or white folk or young folk or older folk. He didn't say preachers. He didn't say deacons. He didn't say women. He didn't say men. He said he that dwelleth in the word he in this text is an all-compassing of all people. And he said, I want you to understand you do not have to fit any certain criteria to be protected. You just have have to be one that sits in the right place. You don't have to be the right person, but you do need to be in the right place. He says, he that dwelleth, which lets me know that this is what's the first indication that this is a sacred place. Because he says, he that dwelleth, dwelleth. He did not say he that dwells. The text says he that dwelleth. In your Bible it says if. Suffix E-T-H. If. That suffix, that three-letter suffix, is critical in understanding this passage of scripture because the suffix if changes everything in the text. See, if we just say dwell, it means that's just where they go. But if it says dwelleth, that's where they stay. Because the suffix F means continues to. What that means is that it means that where dwelleth means to continue to take up residence. It is not a place we retreat to, but a place we reside in. We get in trouble when we keep going in and out. Let me make this plain for you. You know, in my grandmother's house, in the summertime, she didn't have central AC. And she had, grandmama had the window units. And the window units, man, if you close them doors and shut them curtains, it cooled the house. And when we got ready to go outside and play, she getting real mad when you kept going in and out. Some of y'all mad about that too. In and out of her house. And she might say a few things that ain't in the 23rd Psalms. And you kept going in and out of her house. And she got mad because she didn't care nothing about you going in and out. It's not about what's going out. It's not about what's coming in. But it's about what's going out that she got a problem with. Because every time you go in and out, you change the climate in the house. When we feel it holy today, when everything is going, you know it's Sunday. You know how you know it's Sunday. You come in with your Sunday best on, and you churching today, and you all on Facebook. Rest in the Lord and highly favored I am. Oh God, are you coming on my God? You fill up and all that, you know, and all y'all doing. You all church. Got your tongue wrote out and figured out. You got your whole scripture for the day, and then, but then there are certain days of the week. Or you ain't really, you ain't deaconess that day. You ain't all churchy that day. And God don't want me to tell you, look, baby, you're gonna either be in or you're gonna be out. Stop coming in and out of the house. Why is this important? Because what you do is you teach the devil your in and out schedule. Oh, I'm trying to teach this. Y'all ain't listening to me. See, when you are a witness in protection, if the enemy sees your schedule of going in and out, he knows how to find you, and he knows not just where to find you, but he knows when to find you. So watch this now. Not only does he know when to find you, but he knows what it takes to get you high. Like y'all looking at me. Don't make me come down your aisle and talk about what it takes to get you out the house. Okay, so the right text message come through from the right place. You get out the house. If the casino running the right deal, it can get you out the house. If her husband comes. out there. Yeah. If the right hustle comes around, it can get you out the house. And I want you to understand that you are not just tracking mud in God's house, but you are showing Satan your in and out schedule. And if you, God says, I cannot protect you as long as you keep going in and out the house. See, a lot of us, we keep coming down to the church, Lord, we want pastor, I want the pastor to pray for me. I want the church to pray for me. Baby, you'll be all right if you just stay your behind in the house. She got a birthday gift from me 1 year, and I said, baby, come here, daddy, got something for you. And she said, daddy, what is it, from the other side of the room? And I said, no, if you want what I got, it ain't just good enough for you to be in my house, but you got to be in my presence. And I said, so you might come to me to get what you want. And so she came and got it, and then she went back to doing what she was doing. But around 2:30 at night, thunder cracked out, and a storm came in the house. It was thundering and lightning and sirens going off and rain going off. And my baby girl, she's a little gangster until the thunder comes. And she got up, and it was pitch black in the house, and she got up, and she was no longer satisfied with just being in my house. But she had to be in my presence, because in my presence she felt safe. Well, he said, protection. And the psalmist tells us, he lists a bunch of things throughout the latter verses of this chapter that we are protected from. He says the protection in the latter verses is conditional to the dwelling in the first verse, meaning these verses are applicable to this person. You do not get the remaining verses without being loyal to the first verse. See, a lot of them are standing on scriptures we have not been loyal to. You keep saying, God gonna supply all your needs. But the text says, my God shall supply. If he's not your God, then he don't have to supply. All things work together for the good of them that love the Lord. If you don't love the Lord, then all things don't work together for you. You cannot stand on promises you don't qualify for. Oh, what I need you to understand is that these are protection in the right, the latter verses is dependent upon what happens in verse 1. He wants us to understand that it is dishonorable and dangerous to go in and out. This is why convenient church attendance ain't good enough. See, people kill me. They don't go to church until somebody died. And then they want to call here. Well, my grandmother was a long time member, but baby, you wasn't. See, you can't. God's presence is something you have to frequent. The Bible says he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. See, God ain't some cosmic bellhop where you just hear like he's some kind of genie. You pray and he get. No, God says you're going to have to be with me every day. God said, don't call me when you want me. If you ain't with me, then don't ask for me. Be careful not to trap mud in God's house. He says, this is a sacred presence. It's not only sacred, but it's secret. Church, say shh. Everybody say shh. It's a secret. It's a secret. He says, he that dwelleth in the secret place. Not around the secret place, not about the secret place, not behind it, not in front of it, not close to it, but in the secret place. Which lets me know that hanging out on holy ground ain't good enough. Our God does not leave or confine us to the foyer, but he invites us to the secret place. See, we celebrate the fact that God says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. But we have settled for praise at the courts when his presence is at the throne. And I don't know about you, but I don't want no entry-level presence with God. He said, get into the secret place. Not just the, see, you know, I'll tell you why we don't get to the secret place. You and God ain't close like that. Let me make that plain for you. See, when you invite people to your house, for those of us who have, if you have like a formal living room, and then you've got like a den, right? Now, if you invite somebody over for business, and you don't know them, you bring them to the formal living area, and that's where they stay. But you don't usually allow them into your bedroom and your den and your kitchen and the rest of the bathrooms. They have limited access to your house. And usually when they come over, they automatically know they have limited access to your house. And I want to use that as an illustration to explain to you that the reason you don't go deeper with God is because you don't know God like that. You are right with hanging out at the foyer on God's porch. But when you know him, you can walk everywhere with him. Yeah. You can be like grandma and say, he walks with me. Yeah. He talks with me. He tells me I am his own. You can go everywhere with him. My question is, how well do you know him? How close are you with God? Are you with God as close as you are with your mistress? Are you in God as close as you are with the people you hustle with? Do you talk to God as much as you talk to your side beast? Oh, y'all don't like me this morning. My God. Look at how y'all looking at me. Hey. Do you talk to God as much as you talk to your lazy homegirls? Because see, when you go to your best friend's house, you can go hang out anywhere, just lay all out on the couch. But with God, you all buttoned up because you know you don't know God like that. But if you're not close to him, you'll discover that it's amazing when he lets you in his bedroom. I said, you'll discover it's amazing when he lets you back in the den with him. It's amazing when all he knows about you, he'll let you in the throne room. He says, salvation is free and a generic gift. However, this place is reserved for the most dedicated of believers. He says, in the secret place, why is it secret? Because it's the place where the Most High God dwells. Not only referring to God's lordship, but it's referring to his location. Sacred because there is nothing higher than him. He wants you to understand you are. It's secret because you're in sight but out of reach. It means the enemy can see you, but he can't touch it. It's secret. But the last thing I'm done is it's secure. Church says secure. Briggs ain't got nothing on this. He says, now I want you to notice, this is in verse 2, look at verse 2. I want you to notice how throughout the song, it changes points of view. He starts the song speaking in the second person when he says, he that dwelleth. But then in verse 2, he goes from second person to the first person. Because he says, there are certain things I can't talk about for everybody else. I can only talk about for me. He said, this is what happens when you do this. This is what I learned from being in, oh God Almighty, the secret place. He goes from saying he that until to start saying I will. Oh, I wish I had a witness somewhere in the building. He goes from he to I. Because you can't tell it like I tell it. When I found it to be a secret place, you can't tell my testimony better than I can tell. Matter of fact, you can't tell my mess better than I can tell my mess. They can't tell it with one time no way. You can't tell it better than me. He says, he validates the protection by speaking it. Verse 2 says, the psalmist refers to the Lord, meaning the God of control, the God of sovereignty. He says, he is my refuge and my fortress. That word refuge is a military term when one flees his own country as an act of war. But then he says, God is my fortress. That word fortress is a medieval term. It's a medieval term, and back in medieval days, when they built a castle, they would build around the castle a fortress. It was a wall, and in order for someone to do damage to the castle, they had to penetrate the fortress. And he wants you to understand that God is your fortress. Can't nothing happen to you until it comes through him. Good God, I wish I had. This is how God keeps you. Let me see here. Okay. All right. This, okay. So let's say this is you, right? And you in the world, and you are subject to all types of danger. And what God does is, God is not going to exempt you from danger. But what he does is he drops you into what I call a preserver. He keeps you. See, when old folks wanted to preserve, they made preserves. They put it in a preserved mason jar. And they would tighten that jar up. And what that would do is nothing got out and nothing got in. It would preserve the flavors of what the contents was in the jar. And I want you to understand, now I can drop this jar. And watch this. Nothing happens. What happens to the jar does not happen to the contents. Well, I wish I had somebody get excited with me. Now watch this, you can roll this jar, you can keep this jar, you can step on it all you want to, and guess what? Ain't nothing, whatever happens to the jar does not happen to you. That's what happens when God keeps you. You are running around in joy, but it don't happen to God. It happens around you. I said it happens around you, but it don't happen to you. Keep me from what? Keep me from cussing. Keep me from fighting. Keep me from blowing your brains out. Won't it keep you? Story is told about this man who he was a police officer. And he was married to this woman. She said, baby, before you leave, I need you to take this Bible and go to work with you. And he said, baby, I can't take the Bible because it's not a part of the standard uniform. And she said, I tell you what, can you just tuck it in your shirt pocket? And he said, fine, I'll put it there if you'll leave me alone. The man went out on duty, got a call to a residence. He gets there and discovers there's a gunman on the other side of the door. He gets in the door and the gunman starts opening fire. The officer got shot. Falls to the ground. The officer came and checked on him and said, brother, are you all right? He said, I think so. He reached in his chest and found the Bible and caught the bullet. I want to tell you that the word will keep you even if you don't keep the word. Went to jail, but he kept